Hey, space friends, this week I'm talking about microscopic animals, the history behind when we first actually saw them. Magnification lenses existed as far back as 1,000 years ago, possibly even as far back as 3,000 years ago, as there was an unearthed rock crystal lens in Iraq known as the Nimrud lens, although the exact use of it is a little bit unclear. Certainly some of the earliest microscopes were in the late 1500s. There's actually a lot of debate around who created the first microscope and what the first microscope is, and I'm not going to wade into all of that drama, but microscopes are really interesting, and it's really interesting to look at the history of how they came about, and specifically how we were able to actually first see microscopic critters crawling around. Galileo famously also took his telescope lensing technique and used it as a microscope, and he was able to achieve something like between 3 to 9 times magnification, not a whole lot, but it was definitely something. Galileo called his microscope a little eye. In fact, the word microscope itself didn't actually exist really until the year 1625, notably 200 years before the word scientist ever showed up in print. A few decades later, in 1665, Robert Hooke published the book Micrographia, and this was a book of his illustrations of fleas and flies using microscopes at the time. Again, around this time, microscopes were maybe only able to see around 9 times magnification, so he wasn't able to see any microscopic critters, but he was able to look at fleas and flies and other small things that you could see with the naked eye in unprecedented detail. When Micrographia came out, it was so inspiring to a man in his 40s who was a draper. A draper is someone who worked with cloths and linens and would sell them wholesale to people. And so this draper, known as Antonie van Leeuwenhoek, became so inspired by this book of microscopic drawings that he decided himself to actually get into microscopy. He got so into it that he started creating his own lenses. It's possible that even though he worked in fabrics, that may have been the key to actually getting him interested in microscopy. In addition to having this really cool book with all these amazing drawings in it, being a draper at the time meant that you would use magnification lenses to see the quality of the threads. And to be able to show the quality of the threads of the cloths that you're selling, you would be a better business person. Antonie van Leeuwenhoek became so obsessed that he designed dozens of microscopes. He actually created what is known as the first practical microscope in that it's handheld. But the most significant thing that he did was that by creating his own lenses, he was able to achieve significantly more magnification than any lens at the time. So much more. In fact, around the time it's thought that maybe the magnification maxed out at around 9 times. He was able to create lenses that could see 270 times magnification. A huge difference. One of the microscopes he designed is considered practical because it's very simple. It takes a simple ball lens, sandwiches it into a metal plate, and then has a very simple screw on the other side that you can use to twist a specimen around and see it from all angles and get it into perfect focus. At a recent San Francisco Microscopical Society meeting, which is totally nerdy, but I'm a member of their society, at one of their meetings, someone actually had a replica of this practical microscope. And it's very easy. It's handheld, it's very tiny. It might seem definitely outdated today, and it is, but it was something that worked. And really, the innovation here is that he was able to create a lens that was able to see up to 270 times magnification. To demonstrate to you just what a huge leap that is, I actually have behind me here at Field Lab a couple of microscopes that I'm going to use right now to show you the difference. I can't show you the exact magnification difference, but I can show you pretty close. So using my stereoscope, I am actually going to be showing you right now what 10 times magnification looks like. So around the sort of magnification that they had at the time. Again, to be able to see fleas and flies and things of that nature. Now, I'm going to take the exact same sample and show you what it looks like under 200 times magnification with my compound scope. And it's going to really show you how much difference there is between 200 times and 10 times. It's a huge difference. And his ball lenses were able to see 270 times magnification, which is just amazing for the time. Because Antonie's microscopes could magnify so much more, he essentially became one of the very first microscopists and microbiologists. Because Antonie had developed these high-powered lenses, he became the first to see actual single-celled life forms, tiny microscopic life forms existing on their own. known, but no one wanted to believe him. It wasn't until 3 years later that someone was able to actually confirm what he had reported by actually seeing it for themselves. Antonie discovered bacteria, other single-celled life forms, and microscopic animals like nematodes and rotifers. He ended up hiring an illustrator to draw all the amazing creatures that he saw with his microscope and dutifully described all of the creatures and all of their intricacies, almost as if they were beautiful poems. He described bacteria as swimming nimbly and as tiny animals that were in such enormous numbers that all the water seemed to be alive. On one hand, it was really awesome that Antonie was able to create these lenses that were able to see so much more, and he used them to discover and describe so many different life forms. On the other hand, it was sad that it only existed with this one guy, because it wasn't until essentially a century later that people were able to see bacteria again. And then it wasn't until 1877 when German physician Robert Koch was able to publish the very first images of bacteria that anyone had ever seen. But while Antonie van Leeuwenhoek was the only person to crack getting really huge magnification with a very unique way of creating ball lenses, he did use it to discover a lot of things and really create a lot of knowledge in the world. He ended up spending the rest of his life making new discoveries about all sorts of microscopic life forms that no one had known existed before. He also notably spent a lot of time on his microscope studying different behaviors of life forms that really changed our knowledge of how different life forms exist and interact with our world. For instance, at the time, a lot of people believed that shellfish were able to be generated out of sand, or that fleas were able to be created out of dust. He was able to study these organisms and prove that they have reproductive cycles just like any other creature. They don't just appear out of thin air, but they have reproductive cycles and are created like so many other life forms. But by using microscopes and using high-powered microscopes that he developed himself, he was able to not only discover new things, but change our understanding of how the world works. A kind of random thing that I also find interesting is that Antonie was friends with a painter, and this painter was able to use his microscopes to look at a simple drop of water, and it really actually kind of bothered him. The painter wrote to him saying how it transformed a pure and simple thing like a drop of water into something that has strange creatures swirling in it, like a transparent hell. He said that with each new discovery, a new abyss opens. We are more and more lonely in the mysterious void of the universe. To me, it's the endless abyss that I actually love about science, whether it be very tiny things or very large things in outer space. To me, finding more and more things in voids where we thought nothing existed or where we thought things were simple, that's what's really exciting to me. It doesn't make me feel lonely at all. In fact, it makes me feel like we have many more friends in our universe. Just think, we have all these microscopic critters around us every day that we've been sharing our universe with, and we just didn't know it. If anything, we have that many more friends in the universe to share it with. And to me, that's a pretty awesome thing. That's it for me this week, space friends. Thanks so much for tuning in. I really appreciate it. And as always, in the YouTube description below, there are links to this topic and also a shout out to some of the really awesome patrons that are helping support videos like this. If you haven't become a patron yet, do not worry, you can still join my Patreon campaign, and it is still a huge help, and I really, really appreciate it. Otherwise, I will be seeing you all next week, and remember to always be exploring.